through certain basic definitions of Hilbert-Kunz function. So my voice is audible?
Yes, it is very clear. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll go through certain definitions and certain properties of Hilbert-Kunz function. But these properties are already discussed by Kriti to some greater detail, so I'll keep it brief. So let here we take that R is a Noetherian local ring with M is the maximal ideal, and dimension of R is D, and R has positive characteristic P. And I is a M primary ideal, M is a finitely generated R module. And for any natural number, we take Q to be P power N. And I, Frobenius power Q, is the ideal generated by Q power of elements of I. So that is the image of I under the nth Frobenius map. So the Hilbert-Kunz function of M with respect to this ideal is defined as, so for each n, we take this length of this module m mod I Frobenius q times m. Now that q is p power n. So this function was first introduced by Kunz while he was studying singularity for positive characteristic Noetherian local ring. So later, Monsky has proved that this function, like it behaves like in order of q power d. So basically, he proves that HK, the Hilbert-Kunz function of M with respect to I at n, there is a positive real number, I mean greater than equal to 1, such that this number times, it is this number times q power d, and the rest of the growth is of smaller order. So this number, we define this number as the Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity of M with respect to the ideal I. So basically, this multiplicity is length of this module M mod I Q M by Q power D as N tends to infinity. So these are such some properties of HK multiplicity. So this E naught Ri will define the will denote the Hilbert-Samuel multiplicity of R with respect to the ideal I. So E naught R, so we have this inequality. So where D is the dimension of R. So therefore, this means that for dimension one ring, the Hilbert-Samuel multiplicity and Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity are same. Moreover, the Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity has additive property. So suppose that EHK MI is sum over EHK R mod P I times the length of the module MP over RP, where RP is localization of R at the prime ideal P. And this sum is running over all prime ideals such that dimension of R mod P is dimension of R. So like all minimal prime ideals which has proper dimension. And then I mean, it can be seen that if R is regular ring, then EHK of Rm is 1 by Kunz's result. So this was proved by Watanabe and Ashida that when R is formally unmixed, that is the completion of R for all minimal prime of the completion of R has proper dimension, like so this property holds, then the EHK 1 implies that R is regular. So we see that these two properties of EHK are similar to the Hilbert-Samuel multiplicity. So now we establish some relation of Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity of ideals and their tight closure. So suppose R naught be the complement of union of all minimal primes of R, and let I be any ideal of R. Then the tight closure of I is the set of all elements X in R such that there exists an element C in the complement of union of all minimal prime ideals such that C times X power Q is in the nth Frobenius power of I for all large n. And it can be seen that this is a ideal and I is said to be tightly closed if I is equals to I star. So this was shown by Hochstein and Huneke that if J and I are two ideal where this contentment holds and they are primary ideals, then the EHP are same if their tight closure is same. And the converse is also true when R is formally unmixed. So later we'll talk about Hilbert-Kunz density function, and we'll see that this kind of property, this property arity, this arity property. So this kind of property actually descends for the HK density function also. So here is an example of Hilbert-Kunz function. So let's see the irreducible curve in P2, which is given by a degree 3 equation. And let R be the associated homogeneous coordinate ring with maximal ideal M. So then we have this following Hilbert-Kunz, the description of Hilbert-Kunz function. So when C has a cusp, then HK of Rm at Q is 7 by 3 Q squared when P is 3, and when P is not 3, this is the function. So we see that here the Hilbert-Kunz function depends on the prime. And if C is a nodal cubic curve, then we have this definition of the this description of the Hilbert-Kunz function, where so in here we see that it does not depend on the prime P exactly. Moreover, if C is an elliptic curve and the prime is not equal to 2, then we have this description of the Hilbert-Kunz function. So here the first one was studied by Kunz, also separately by Konka and Pardue. Here the second one was done by Bachweig and Chen. The third one was also done by them. And for the third one, for P equals to 2, it is done by Monsky. I mean, I have not included it. The description is a bit complicated. So here in this example, we see that the first coefficient we have is first coefficient. The Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity is 7 by 3. However, there is a chance of existing a second coefficient here. So like the question is whether there exists a second coefficient for the Hilbert-Kunz function, and this was shown by Huneke, McDermott and Monsky that actually it does. So am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Yes.
Okay. I just want to make sure.
Yeah.
So now we show that this, Huneke, McDermott and Monsky have proved this. So we give some steps of their proof. So they have actually proved for all excellent normal Noetherian local rings and for all finally generated module. However, suppose that R is an excellent normal Noetherian local domain and dimension R is D, and characteristic of R is P, and R has a perfect residue field, and R is an imprimary ideal. And so for any torsion free finally generated R module, they have studied this limit. So if one needs to study the second coefficient, one needs to first take care of the growth of the top order. So here this is the Hilbert-Kunz function. And then we subtract this this number, which actually subtracts the top order growth. And then they show that this limit exists, and for torsion free modules. And the so this limit we denoted by tau mi. And they also show that this tau, this number does not depend exactly on the module, but their class in the class group of R. So the divisor class group modulo the principal divisor group. So basically, this tau gives a map from the class group of R to the real number. So now we have this number. And then Huneke, McDermott and Monsky, they have shown that this if one R is the this is the R module R via the Frobenius map. So the action of R times X, if X is in R, it is R power P times X. So then they show that beta of mi is mi can be taken from this from the tau from this number tau, and this beta mi serves as the second coefficient for the Hilbert-Kunz function. So they show that the Hilbert-Kunz function is EHK mi times q power d plus beta mi times q power d minus 1 plus smaller order growth. So note that since tau is a function in the class group, so if the class group is 0 or if it is a torsion group, then this is 0. So they have shown, this is also shown by the first point, was also shown by Huneke, McDermott and Mosky. They have shown that if R is a complete local normal two-dimensional ring and the residue field is algebraic closure of the finite field with p elements, then the class group is torsion and therefore the tau map is 0. Kurano has shown that Kurano has also studied this class group, and he has shown that the second coefficient is 0. I mean, we are in the X-plane normal complete Noetherian domain. So Noetherian ring, I guess. So he shows that this beta mi is 0 when R is Q Gorenstein ring and M has finite projective dimension. And later Chan and Kurano and Hochster, Yao, they have extended the existence of second coefficient for normal rings which satisfies the R1 condition. And in 2009, Bruns and Gubulas has shown that the HK function of a normal affine monoid is a quasi-polynomial. So we do not exactly know how the HK function behaves after the second coefficient, but they show that for normal affine monoid is a quasi-polynomial, and along with the first coefficient, the second coefficient is also constant. So now we discuss the Hilbert-Kunz density function. So this function is a nice in the sense it's continuous and compactly supported continuous function, and it estimates the Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity. Moreover, it is also like uniform limit of nice step function or piecewise linear continuous function. So it is sometimes useful to work with this function. So let R is a we are in the graded case now. So let R is a standard graded Noetherian ring of dimension d, and over a perfect field k, and characteristic of R is p. So and I is a homogeneous ideal such that length of R mod I is finite, and M is a finitely generated non-negatively graded R module. So then we define for M and I. And for each n, each natural number, q is p power n. So we define fn mi is, so it's a function from the positive real axis to the positive real axis. So it is length of this module at the q lambda floor graded piece and scaled by 1 over q power d minus 1. So then we show that, Trivedi has shown that this these sequence of functions, they have convergence uniformly to a function fmi, where fmi is a compactly supported continuous function and its integration is the Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity. So this function, we call it the Hilbert-Kunz density function, and we denote it by hkdmi. So recently, Professor Tivedi and Professor Watanabe have proved the existence of Hilbert-Kunz density. So they have generalized the definition such that it coincides with the standard graded case when for the Hilbert-Kunz density function, and they have shown the existence for a density function which again similarly is a uniform limit of nice functions and whose integration is the Hilbert-Kunz multiplicity. So they have shown it for all n-graded Noetherian domains. So now here is some of the HK density function. So this property, as we see that these are very similar to the Hilbert Kuhn multiplicity. So let lambda be the set of all minimal prime ideals of, so this should be okay, all minimal prime ideals of R such that they has the correct dimension, and then the HKD is also additive as it was for EHK. Now if R is formally unmixed and I and J are two homogeneous ideals of finite colon, then their HKD is a Hilbert-Kunz density functions of R with respect to these two ideals are same if and only if their type closure are same. So this one actually follows directly from the property of EHK. The additivity requires a substantial amount of proof. So however, the second property, note that if these two are same, then the EHK is also same. So therefore, the type closure of the ideals are same. And conversely, the type closures of the ideals are same, then EHK are same. But this function is bigger than this function always. So therefore, their difference, the integration of their difference is zero. But this is a continuous function, so they are zero. The difference is zero. So now we give that there is a this. Now we give a description of a multiplicative property of Hilbert-Kunz density function, and so this is not so generally EHK is not such a, does not have such multiplicative property. So suppose S is another standard graded ring, then it can be shown that there is such so this is the second product of R and S. So it can be shown that there is such relation, where these are the HK density function of the secondary product, so these are the HK density function of R with respect to I, this is HK density function of S with respect to J, and FR, FS and FR has the secondary product, they are non polynomial functions and they depend only on the Hilbert Samuel multiplicity of these rings with respect to their respective maximal ideals. So these results are recently shown by Ribedi and Watanabe. So they have studied the support of the Hilbert-Kunz density function, and they have seen that, so suppose alpha mi is the maximum support of the Hilbert-Kunz density function of fmi. So, and if I is a ideal which is generated by a homogeneous system of parameters f1 up to fd and their degrees are given by n i's, then this maximal support is sum of this these number, these degrees, and also this is equal to the f threshold of the homogeneous maximum ideal with respect to this ideal I. I'm not defining f threshold, we are not going to use it, but I am just going to state the property. So moreover, they also show that this Hilbert-Kunz density function is symmetric with respect to this number by 2. So this is another property: when R is a domain, then this support is D if and only if R is regular. If R is a domain, then F is symmetric at the point D by 2 if and only if R is regular. This last one follows from the earlier two, because if R is regular, the name is generated by degree 1 elements, D many elements. So we get this, and if we have this equality, then we get alpha Rn equals to D. So we get that R is regular. So now we study affine monoid rings and Hilbert-Kunz theory on affine monoid rings. So a monoid is said to be affine if it is finitely generated and it is inside some Z-R for some R. So we will assume all our monoids are affine, and a monoid M is said to be normal if M is saturated in the group generated by this monoid. So that is, if K times X is in M, where K is a natural number and X is in the group, then X should belong to M. So now this normality of M, it shows that if F is any field, then this monoid algebra is an integrally closed domain if and only if M is normal. So this was shown by Watanabe in 2000 that if R is a affine monoid algebra for a normal monoid ring, then and K is a field of characteristic P positive, and I is a monomial ideal of finite pole length, then Watanabe has shown that EHK of R is rational. So he has actually expressed EHK as sum of weighted sum of relative volume of certain region which has rational volume. So now suppose M is any monoid and K is a field, and now we describe, so I is a monomial ideal, it is given by these monomials where AI are in M. Then we can define a so basically first, yeah, it's fine. So let C be the convex rational polyhedral coil generated by M. So it should be inside RR, sorry, RD, it should be, this jader should be RD. So basically all positive linear combination of finite positive linear combination of elements of M. So C is that cone. And P is the set where we take this cone C and we translate the cone C at each of these point AI and we subtract those sets. So P is the set where X is in this cone, but X is not in any of this translated cone. So then Ito has shown that EHK of the monoid algebra with respect to this ideal is the relative volume of this set, of the closure of this set. So now we will define a polytopal monoid algebra. So like P. So even though I'll take P is inside R D minus one, so that the monoid is in R D and the ring, the algebra, monoid algebra becomes D dimensional. So if P is inside R D minus one, it's a lattice polytope. So a polytopal monoid in R D associated to the polytope P is generated by, so we take all lattice points of P, we translate it to one dimension higher and we put it at level one, and then we take the monoid generated by these elements. So I'll just go to the next slide and I'll show what I mean. So here P is a D minus one dimensional, so that is two. So two dimensional polytope, we have put it at z equals to one plane in R3, and then this is the cone generated by P, and MP is the monoid generated by these points, these points. So I mean, for the simplicity, we will denote MP by M only. And the monoid algebra is associated to this monoid. So note that this monoid algebra will be inside this ring. So and again, for the simplicity, we denote this monoid algebra and with respect to its homogeneous maximal ideal, which is generated by these points, these functions, by Rm. And now, what is a normal polytope? P is said to be a normal polytope if all lattice points of P and plus all lattice points of LP gives us the all lattice points of K plus LP. So basically, P is normal if P has enough points to generate all lattice points of integer multiples of P. So that is the another condition here. And it can be shown that P is normal if and only if the monoid MP equals to C intersection ZD. Note that MP will be inside this, so this is the cone C, so MP will be inside C intersection ZD, but if MP is equals to this, then P is normal. So we'll assume the dimension of P is D minus one. I mean, we can assume that by taking the affine half of P, and we will assume K is algebraically closed up at test T positive, and we will also assume that P is a normal polytope and M is a normal monoid. This we will assume for the simplicity, and we also note that this has a geometric interpretation. This given a normal lattice polytope, it can be thought of as a generator of the global section of a toric variety with respect to a torus invariant very ample Cartier divisor. However, we are not going to use this interpretation. So now we study the prime ideals of this polytopal monoid algebra, monomial prime ideals to be precise. So let F be any face of the polytope, and CF is the cone generated by this set in RD. So F intersection ZD should be. So all lattice point of F in RD. So basically, so if F is this face, then CF is the cone generated here. So CF is the cone generated by this point and this point. So and suppose that PF is the ideal which is generated by the set of monomials which are not in, like, which arise from the lattice points which are not in CF. So PF is the ideal which is generated by all mono, all elements lattice points here, but not any lattice points here. So then for this polytopal monoid algebra, there is a one-one correspondence between the sets of faces of the polytope and the sets of monomial prime ideals of R, and this given by F is mapped to PF. And under this correspondence, height one prime ideals correspond to the facets of P. So facets are like codimension one faces of P. So let divisor of R be the free abelian group on the set of height one prime ideals of R, and divisor of M is the subgroup of divisor of R where it is generated by Heitel monomial prime ideals, and Prince M is the subgroup generated by principal monomial ideals. So then the class group of M is denoted by the group quotiented, the group divisor of M quotiented by the principal divisors of M. And it is generated by the classes of the ideals PF. For PF, we have defined, and for all facets of P. And it is isomorphic to the class group of R. So we have a convex geometrical description of the class group of R. So let so now we will state the results. And so let C be the cone generated by M. So C, as we have already seen, C is this cone, and P is C minus all the translated cones where it is translated at the lattice points of P, and which is up at the level one. So then this is a result with Professor Tibedi, that we have shown that the Hilbert-Kunz density function of Rm can be expressed as the relative volume of these slices of this set P. Note that this set P was introduced by Ito. However, he has shown that this EHK is the volume of relative volume of this set. So we show that HK density function is the relative volume of the slices of this set, and moreover, it is a piecewise polynomial function. So here is a. So is there some?
There is a question.
Okay.
Just a minute. Question from Miyazaki is. Prince M isomorphic to pick M over divisor M
Peking, what is peak? I do not know what is a Kikadu for a monoid.
So I request Miyazaki to open the mic and ask the question. Yes, Miyazaki.
Oh, thank you. Is the pink hand is not isomorphic to the divisor class group? Divisor class group. I missed the writing of question, but the divisor class group mod div m cap the divisor class group of m. My question is that prink m is isomorphic to the divisor class group mod div m.
Okay, I mean, so if the divisor class group, I mean, is this one, this is the generated by Hightower, but I mean, I that class group of R is not isomorphic to the Picard group of the Turing variety. I mean, that is different because the class group can be torsion, whereas the like for P2 or something. And but here, what is the divisor? Is there another definition of divisor class group for the monoid?
Yeah, I see. So it's different. Divisor class group of mod Prinkem is different. Divisor class group CLR mod DVM is different from CLM. My question is, so you mean that it is different? It is
okay.
Not as
okay.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, I think I have learned something. So we were describing this HK density function. So I give an example here. So this is the polytope which is generated by zero. So this is a one-dimensional polytope. So which is generated, which is the convex hull of 0 and 3. So and we, I mean, we put it in R2. So we put it at level 1, and then this is the cone. These are the translated cones. These are the translated cones at each of the lattice point of the polytope. So we have subtracted them, and then this blue area is the set P. And so the HK density function at each level is the volume of the slice. So here we are in full dimensional case. So this is just volume. We do not need relative volume. So here the HK density function at some 1 plus 1 by 4 should be volume of these three segments. So now the question is, similar to the HK density function, can we say that there exists another sequence of nice functions which converges uniformly such that we get another function GRM, and it the integration of this function gives the second coefficient. So and moreover, if we can replace R by M in this question. So this is a result with Professor Trivedi, where we answer this question affirmatively. So we define this GN from the positive real axis to all real number. So where again we take this length of this module at this lambda cube, floor of lambda cube graded piece. And then again, we want to subtract the growth of the highest order. So, and we therefore we subtract the density function at this weight. So this is the floor of lambda cube mod cube, and we scale it by q power d minus 1. So, and this is multiplied by 1 by q power d minus 2. And we hope that this function will give us the second coefficient. The, I mean, the, they will converge to a nice function, and which will give us the second coefficient. So we show that outside, so there is a finite set which I am not going to define, but there is a finite set outside which we show that these functions gn converges uniformly to a nice function grm. This grm is given by this description. So this grm can be expressed as the volume of the relative volume d minus two dimensional relative volume of the boundary of this set P and the cone C. And then we also get that the integration of grm gives us the second coefficient. So now, so suppose that F is a facet of P and I is the monomial prime ideal of height 1. So, and sigma F is the support function for the facet CF of C. So, so sigma F is the linear form which defines this hyperplane. And HFU is the translate of these hyperplanes for any mu. And we define mu df to be like all such translates which contain a lattice point of P, a P minus F. So probably I'll, so here these could be HF mu for mu in that particular set. So if this is F and this point is F for the polytope, so this is CF. And these could be HF mu. Then we define a function psi f, which is so this is again described as the boundary of the set P, but like boundary, this is a slices of the volume of the set P which are parallel to the facet CF of C. So this is the relative volume that we define, and then we also assert that this is outside a finite set, this function is continuous and is given by a piecewise polynomial function. And as before, for this ideal I, we define GNIM, a sequence of function, by the length of the module I mod m q I at the graded piece floor of q lambda, and we subtract the hk density function of appropriate weight and multiply it by q power d minus 1, and the whole thing is scaled by 1 over q power d minus 2. And then we show that these functions, this sequence of functions, converges to a nice function gim, which is also outside a finite set, compactly supported and continuous. And moreover, GIM has this description that GIM is GRM minus, so this is the Hilbert-Kunz density function of the standard grading R mod I with respect to the ideal M mod I, and plus the function psi f that we have defined earlier. And we show that the second coefficient is integration of this function. So we show that like the Hilbert-Kunz density function, the beta density, so we call these functions GIM and GRM as beta density function of R and I with respect to the maximal ideal M. So we show that like the Hilbert-Kunz density function, the beta density function also has a multiplicative property. And one uses the multiplicative property of the HK density function to get such nice formula. So here, this is the beta density function for the Segre product of two polytopal rings, and this is the density function, beta density function for R. This is the beta density function for S, and these are the Hilbert-Kunz density function here. And FR, FS are already I have introduced. I have not actually, but I have talked about them. And the so, and GR, G for a ring, for a standard graded ring, GR is a polynomial function which depends on the second coefficient of the Hilbert-Samuel polynomial of M with respect to the ideal M. So GR is a very nice function. And then we get this nice formula for R and S, and also for the ideals of the Segre product. We note that these form the Heitorn monomial prime ideal of the Segre product. I mean, these Heitorn monomial prime ideal of the Segre product are of these forms. So therefore, if we know the beta density function for two rings, we know it for their Segre product also. So now I give an example here. So let P is the triangle, which is the triangle is, it has vertices at 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 1. So this polytope will give the coordinate ring of P2 and with respect to the line bundle of P2, 1. So we know that Hilbert-Kunz function has this shape. So therefore, the beta of Rn is 0. However, this is by our description of the HK density function, we can compute this. We can compute directly also. And we get this HK density function is a piecewise polynomial function which is given like this. And it is 0 for lambda bigger than 3. And then we compute the Gn lambda. So we get such description and we get that the beta density function is given by this piecewise polynomial function and 0 for lambda bigger than 3. And therefore we get that integration is 0, which is beta of Rn. Now remember that Huneke, McDermott and Monsky has defined a map from the class group of R. And for the ideal I equals to PF, which is obtained from the facet F, we define another function alpha Im by putting this formula. And so therefore it can be shown that from the relation of tau and beta, it can be shown that this integration of alpha Im is giving us the tau function. So moreover, since we know that these ideals generate the class group, therefore we can also say that we can, for any know their class group, we know their class in the class group, then we can define a function alpha mm such that its integration is tau of mm. And also for Segre product of rings, we get a formula. So these are some examples which are not explicit. I mean, from the definition of the beta density function, we can express them in terms of the HK density function of the smaller dimensional rings, and also we can do this and this psi function that we have defined earlier, and we can compute these functions for different toric surfaces which are polytopal rings, and we can compute the Segre product of toric surfaces also. So here is an example. This example was introduced by Professor Watanabe. And so let M is a 2x3 matrix, and whose entries are these 6 independent variables. And T is the quotient of the polynomial ring by these independent variables by the 2x2 minors of M. So this is a binomial ideal, and it gives a toric variety, and it is actually the Segre product of P1 and P2. So this was shown by Professor Watanabe that beta of this ring with respect to the maximal ideal is -1/4. And Huneke, McDermott, and Monsky have referred to this example to show that this map is, so the tau map is not necessarily a zero map. Note that they have noted that for two-dimensional ring, this is, the tau is a zero map. And if the class group is torsion, then also it's a zero map. So, but here they show that it is not a zero map. And so therefore we compute this tau for this this ring for all the high tone monomial prime ideals. So note that this so-called R is the polytuple ring which is associated to the convex R of 0, 1, and S is another polytuple ring which is associated to so this one we have already studied in the previous example, this example. And then if we take the so we know that there are two high tone monomial prime ideals of R and three for S, and we compute the beta density function for them. So it can be shown that, I mean, these are the so it is given by such piecewise polynomial function which is zero for lambda bigger than three, and therefore we get this tau for these ideals for the ring T. So now I'll give a brief sketch of some main points of the proof. So first we define that Erard quasi polynomial. So say Q is a rational convex rational polytope, and then we count the integer the lattice points of the dialets of Q, and it was shown by Erard that it is a quasi polynomial. So that is, this is a polynomial like this where the coefficients are periodical with integer period, and it has degree dimension Q. And moreover, if the affine Hall of Q contains an integer point, then they show that the first coefficient is the constant, and it is given by the relative volume of this polytope. And if the affine Hall of the facets of all of the facet contains integer point, lattice points, then they show that the second coefficient is also constant, and it is given by the dimension Q minus 1 dimension relative volume of the facet. So this is a result with Professor Trivedi, where we show that if we have a polytope in RD and we take all j equals to lambda slices, so q lambda is this slices, we have this polytope and we cut it down by this hyperplane, and then if we take the Erard polynomial of these polytopes, then we show that these numbers are actually uniformly bounded, it does not depend on the lambda. I mean, so we use this Minkowski sum, Erard polynomials for Minkowski sum of polytopes, and a result by Hink and Linke. But we will here we will just state this and we will use it in the sketch. So remember this cone that we have generated by this monoid M, and we decompose this cone by further smaller subcones, d-dimensional subcones, such that. So I'll show a picture here. So this was a polytope we have seen it earlier, and then this is the Ito set introduced by Ito, and and we have shown that the HK density function is relative volume of this set, and the beta density function is relative volume of the boundary in some way. So what we do is that we divide this set in, first we divide the cone in some smaller cones such that the intersection with P becomes a locally closed set, and it's so note that intersection with P will not have these lines because they were subtracted, and their closures are polytope. So we show that such a thing is possible. So that's what is described here, that C is union of these cones, and such that this set is union of course union of this and this pj primes are locally closed set, and they are pj are closure of pj prime in RD, and pj are d dimensional rational convex polytope which contains the origin. Moreover, you also show that their intersection is a face of both of pi and pj, and therefore their dimension drops. So they do not intersect in the interior. And also we show that the facets of PG are transversal to the Z hyperplane. So therefore the boundary, when we intersect with this hyperplane, the dimension drops. So here we show that these facets are, all the facets are transversal. So I mean, this is the, so we show that. Now for any bounded set, we were counting the lattice points of the dilated polytope, but here we count the lattice points of the dilated polytope also when we intersection with the Z hyperplane at label M. And then it can be shown that the FN RM, the sequential functions of the Hilbert-Kunz density function, are this number by scaled with this scale is this 1 over q power d minus 1. And then for, we show that for this set, which is a dense subset of the positive real axis, we show that HK density function is sum of volume of these polytopes. So sum of these, sum of relative volume of these polytopes. Which one? So, and then because this HK density function is continuous, and we also saw that these functions are continuous, even though it was already proved in the literature, but we also prove it. And then we show that these, therefore these two functions are equal. Now we study the boundary of P. So here is a description that boundary of P can be described in terms of the facets of these polytopes that we have got print from the decomposition of the cone. So note that these blue sets are P1, P2, P3, and with these lines, I mean, these are P1 primes, P2 primes, and with these lines, they are P1. So they are, so we formally proved that PJ is PJ prime, and with disjoint union with some facet EJ gamma, which are facets of PJs. And such that EJ gammas are disjoint from this PI prime for all I prime, because EJ's gammas will be inside these translated cones, inside these translated cones, and therefore, and PI primes are not, they are inside this set C minus union of these sets. And then we can show that such a thing happens where these are union of polytopes, and here we are counting the lattice points, and then using this description of the lattice points of P, we show that for this lambda in the dense set, apart from some finite sets, we show that GN lambda has such a description where these are the d minus 2, the coefficient of q power d minus 2 for these polytopes at the sectional, like PJ intersection Z equals to lambda for these polytopes. And with this description, we show that these functions converges to the GRM that we have defined. And for any lambda, which for arbitrary lambda, we show that this GRM lambda can be less than these two quantity, where this is small because GRM is continuous and this is small. For that, we use the uniform bound of the coefficients of error polynomial that we had proved earlier. We use this theorem. So now, for the proof of the existence of the density function, beta density function for the ideals, we first show that these ideals can also be generated by their degree one elements. So, and then we define this sequence of functions in, which is the length of intersection of the nth Frobenius ideal of nth Frobenius power of M intersection with I, and modulo their product. And the length is taken at this graded piece. And then we show that using a similar approach as before, we show that we use this first point also, and then we show that this sequence of function converges uniformly to psi f, where psi f we have defined earlier. So this is the function psi f that also we show that these the sequential function of the Hilbert-Kruse density function for this ring R mod I and M with respect to the maximal ideal M mod I, it can be given this interpretation in terms of the set P and the cone CF, and use this to show that G and IM can be written in terms of these three functions psi n, Fn and G and Rn that we have defined earlier, and then we use the convergence of each of them to show that these functions converges and their integration yields the beta coefficient of the Hilbert-Kruse function. Okay, so I think I will stop here. So these are the references.
thank you, Mandira, for your nice talk. We open now for questions. Are there any questions? Yeah, what about local version of some of these results? For example, you gave interpretation for coefficient of q to the d minus 1 in graded case.
Yes.
One can ask whether this is true in the local case.
The same question can be asked for the Hilbert-Kruse multiplicity also.
Right.
As of now, I don't know, and I think, because in the graded case, we are using the degree of the, very extensively. So, right now, I do not know. So we have to be able to give a grading on the local rings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there is a question, what happens if we restrict, just a minute.
To the Hilbert rings.
Yeah, what happens if you restrict your attention to Hilbert rings? Yeah.
So that actually I do not know. I would like to know that. This is a question that has come to my mind, but I do not know as of now.
Mm-hmm. So in the local case, you are saying we can construct analog of Hilbert-Kruse density function so that the E1 coefficient in the local case has an interpretation. Are you saying that this is done or it is possible?
No, I did not say that it is done. I am saying that it is an interesting prospect, but I do not know how it can be done.
Okay.
I think Professor Tibedi or Professor Watanabe can answer because they have done for more general case.
Yeah, so if they have comments, you please. So the question is about the local case, whether some of these results are done for local case. Yeah, Vijayalakshmi, do you know whether local situation is studied?
No, it is. It's very difficult, I guess. How do you define a grading? This function is defined, but the basis of grading, at the most, you can take graded ring and all, but the Hilbert-Kruse multiplicity of a graded ring is not equal related with the Hilbert-Kruse multiplicity of the local ring. In fact, there is some kind of inequality or something at the most you can prove. So you can't, I don't see anything.
But I vaguely remember that in one of your talks, you said if you integrate from 0 to 1, you get Hilbert-Samuel multiplicity.
Yeah, that's for graded rings.
Okay, well, only for graded rings. Okay.
Yeah. Function is defined only for graded rings.
All right. Okay, you are okay because you are referring to the graded components, right?
And what Mandira is talking, she's talking for projective toric varieties, actually. Mm-hmm. So okay. It's not covering all affine monoid as such. What Watanabe and Ito have defined for any affine monoid, so that's a more general class.
Yeah.
Okay.
So these are polytopal monoid.
Mm. Yeah. Right. Yeah. You gave analog of Professor Watanabe. You had some comment.
Can you say something about geometric data of polytopes using Hilbert-Kunz density function?
Geometric data of the polytopes?
Yeah.
Okay. So one thing that this is a result with Professor Trivedi that we had shown that the asymptotic growth of EHK that you mm-hmm. and Professor Asida have studied earlier mm-hmm. that with relative to the E0. So that that asymptotic growth is smallest if and only if the polytope tiles the space. So that is one interpretation in relation with the polytope and the algebraic property of the ring.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Are there further questions? If not, let us thank the speaker, Mandira, once again for a very interesting talk. Yeah. And we wish.